Okay, so recording camera. This slate is 5th of November 2021, interview with Philip Maisel in Melbourne, Australia, conducted by Stephen Smith via Zoom from Los Angeles, we think, unless you're somewhere else. And this is take one of hopefully one or two or three. Okay, just hold that there. And okay, put the paper down, Philip, and Stephen can start.
Thank you. Well, Philip, myself, thank you so much for being with us today at USC Shoah Foundation. It's my pleasure to speak to you. I have to tell you, the work that you have done over many years in collecting testimonies of Holocaust survivors is one of the most remarkable archives of testimony that there are in the world. And today we're here to talk about the Philip Maisel Holocaust Collection and how it came about, the work you did, and the legacy that you are leaving the world with this remarkable collection, and to understand more about it. So, Philip, thank you so much for joining us today here on the 5th of November, 2021.
Thanks, it's a big honor to talk to you. And it was extremely important for me to meet you. I learned from you quite a lot.
Well, thank you, Philip. So I'd like to begin just by asking you if you could tell me your full name.
My full name is Philip Falk. I was called Falk Maisel.
Can you tell me your name at birth?
At birth, I was called Falk, and at home, they called me Fala. So, still, just because Fala sounds like a girl's name, my cousin changed it to Philip, and I stayed with it. That was just after I arrived to Australia in 1950.
Now, you have actually done an interview yourself about your experiences during the Holocaust. So this interview will not be specifically about your Holocaust experience, but I would like to ask you just a few biographical details at the beginning of this interview. First of all, could you tell me where and when you were born?
I was born in Vienna. At the present moment, it's called Vilnius because it's the capital of Lithuania, on the 15th of August, 1922.
And Philip, would you tell me just the names of your immediate family, that your parents and your siblings?
My father was called Samuel, my mother Slava. I have a twin sister, Bella, and a brother who passed away, who was 6 years older, Joseph.
During the Holocaust period, Philip, could you just tell me where you were and when, the steps that you took through the Holocaust, just so that we get a sense of the trajectory of your experience during the Holocaust?
It's actually during the Holocaust, first were locked up in the ghetto. Later I was deported to Estonia. From Estonia, they brought me back to Europe to concentration camp Stutthof. I stayed there approximately a month. From Stutthof, they sent me to Dautmergen, which was very, very bad camp. And from Dautmergen, they sent me to Frommern. Frommern was not a camp for Jewish people, but for concentration camp where a few hundred French, Belgian, and Dutch people, where conditions were extremely good comparing with the previous concentration camps.
And I was liberated. Can you tell me the name of the camps that you were in Estonia?
Actually, I was in many different camps because I was working as an automotive electrician in a garage which was traveling all over Australia, repairing the cars in every camp which was where the repairs were required. The biggest camp was Kivioli. The first camp I arrived was Auvere. One of them was Ereda, and Unfortunately, I can't remember the rest.
And those camps were all in Estonia, right?
Yeah, about 7 camps.
Yeah. So where were you liberated, Philip?
In Germany, in a little town in southern Germany called Ostrach.
Ostrach. Do you know how to spell that?
Pardon?
Do you know how to spell
yeah.
that?
Yeah, O-S-T-R-A-C-H.
Ostrach. Thank you. So I'm very interested to find out how you made your way to Australia. What was it that brought you to Australia and how and when?
Actually, in 1948, there was a big danger of the Third World War breaking down. It was a Cold War. At this stage, the Berlin was divided by four parts, but it was surrounded by Soviet troops. Every 3 minutes, a Soviet plane, sorry, an American plane, landed in Berlin to pick up some people, to take them away from Berlin, and to bring some supplies. And the danger of the Third World breaking out was very acute. So I just wanted to escape from Europe. At the same time, I got a letter from my uncle from Australia, who invited me to come. And in January 49, 19th of January, I arrived in Australia.
When you arrived in Australia, how did you establish yourself? Did you start work? What was your process of becoming
Actually,
an Australian?
I came to Australia. I came on Thursday. Monday, I already started to work in a garage. The job which they gave me was cleaning floors and lubricating cars. And I was very, very impressed by Australia because I had the experience that while one of the customers who car lubricated, which was actually Coles, you know, the owner of a big store here, shook my hand and gave me a small tip. In Europe, it was, I couldn't imagine that I could meet such a prominent person that he would shake my hand and even give me a tip. That was a very, very pleasant experience. But
had you completed any education prior to World War II?
So basically, I never had any professional education. In ghetto, to survive, you had to have a trade which was useful for Germans. And a friend of my father said that in an institution called HKP, which was repairing cars, which was very important for Germans, they need an automotive electrician. And my father decided that I'm an automotive electrician. At this stage, I never even looked under the bonnet of the car, and I hardly knew anything about electricity. But at work, people helped me, and there was a library, Strashuden Library, one of the biggest libraries, Jewish libraries in Europe, in the same street in the ghetto where I was living, and I could pick up all the information from the library. So in about 6 months, I was a professional electrician, could solve all the problems, and actually had the big advantage that I was solving problems which generally be not solved because people thought things can't be repaired, but I didn't know about it. And having a lot of spare parts of the cars which were broken down and couldn't be used anymore. I could repair them, so I did comparatively well. The Germans felt that I'm very smart.
So you were self-taught then?
I'm self-taught, yes.
How did you make your career when you did come to Australia? What was your career?
So, to me, Australia was a very lucky country. I left the job after a week's time because a very simple incident. They told me to change change wheels on the car. But instead of saying change wheels on the car, they change tires on the car, rotate the tires. So instead of changing the wheels, I removed the tire from each wheel. And it took me 3 hours, a job which was supposed to take about half an hour. Naturally, the foreman was very, very upset. And just because I felt he didn't appreciate my work, I decided to leave without collecting the pay. But fortunately, the girl who had fried the pie, they had to give me my pie, ran after me, handed my envelope, and gave me much more money than I expected because I was working overtime without knowing about it. I almost came back. But naturally, I didn't. And I went to firm Keller and Faulkner, which was selling Rolls Royces and Bentleys and so on. And they checked my knowledge. But in 1 week, I learned a bit of English. I could answer the question very well. And I started to work there. The most interesting experience I had, I lost a screw from a starter motor because my English was not perfect. I decided instead of going to the store and ask for a replacement screw, I will look it on the floor for half an hour. At the end of the work, the foreman congratulated me that I took much longer to repair the starter motor than usual and told that I should be an example to all the workers. They should follow the way I'm working, because the longer it will take to repair a car, the more workers will be employed, and it's very good for the trade union.
And so did you stay in the motor industry all of your life?
Yes. Yes, until I retired. Then I tried to financially secure my family. And once I have done that, I came to the Holocaust Center. I was invited.
So can I ask you, what was it like for you living in Australia as a Holocaust survivor and as a Jewish person? Were you accepted when you came to live in Australia?
Actually, I didn't feel any discrimination as a Jewish person. To me, Australia was a blessed country. The people were kind, polite. I could always find a job. I worked on the weekends. I was installing burglar alarms in the car. I learned English comparatively fast. I had English for 2 years at school, actually. But when I came to Australia, I assumed that people don't speak the same language. It was so different from the English I learned in Poland. It was with a Polish accent. And I suppose my English teacher wasn't a perfect teacher as well.
And so, did you find that you were, did you make friends with other Holocaust survivors? Did you know other Holocaust survivors?
Actually, this was actually one of the characteristic of the Holocaust survivor. People in Australia, including my uncle, couldn't believe that in the conditions which were, we described the concentration camp, we could survive. So the Holocaust survivors, whenever they met, they talk about their experiences during the Holocaust. But this never included people who are not survivors. My wife was born, was Jewish here, but she was an Australian, and she didn't want to know anything about the Holocaust because if it was so terrible, she simply couldn't accept that people could survive this condition. And to be honest, people couldn't believe that Germans could be so cruel. It's a Western nation.
Did you ever speak about your experiences?
To my uncle, yes. And
to your uncle, you did?
Yeah.
But did you speak publicly about the fact that you were a Holocaust survivor?
Later on, since when I started to work in the Holocaust, very frequently, yes.
And when was that? When did you begin?
I was interviewed quite often, and I had an attempt, I actually made an attempt to speak about the Holocaust to anybody I met. I felt there is a lesson humanity can learn from the Holocaust, and this is very important.
And so when did you start doing that? Speaking about it?
Yeah, I was about approximately 70 year old. And when I was in the camp, I promised my friends that should we promise one another, if we will survive, even for 5 minutes, we will tell the world what happened during the Holocaust. And later on, by working in the Holocaust Museum, I had an opportunity to do it.
I have often heard that, Philip, that the victims during the period had that conversation about that if you survive, tell the world. Can you confirm to me that those conversations actually did take place in the camps at the time?
Yes, yes. You see, the chance of survival at certain time was very, very small. And it's in the human nature that you want people to know what actually happened during the Holocaust. There was a danger that nobody survived the Holocaust. So it was quite common, I suppose. It's other people did exactly the same thing. I want to survive to be able to tell what happened.
And do you see your work today as a fulfillment of that promise?
To a very great extent, yes. You see, while collecting testimonies, I had very, very gruesome stories. And the fact that I collect them for the future generation made it easier to listen to it. Because this psychologically affects, it affects a person. If not immediately, usually after I came home, all the memories came back. The most, I wouldn't say strange thing, but the interesting thing was that people usually talked a lot about how other people suffered. It wasn't their personal suffering, but the suffering of their relatives, of their family, of their community, which affected them very badly.
So I'd like to go now to the origins of your work and ask you how it was that you were inspired to start taking testimony of other Holocaust survivors.
Actually, when I was in Germany, I was working for UNRWA, United Nations Relief and Refugee Organization, administration. And one of my jobs was to interview people to check if they deserve the status of a refugee. And then I got a bit of experience in interviewing. Later on, when I was working in a Holocaust center, I was working initially in archives. Saba Feniker approached me and said, would I like to start collecting testimony for Holocaust Center? The advantage was that I could fully devote my time. Previously, people did it sporadically. Sometimes there were months could pass before a testimony would be collected. Being 70, I realized how urgent it is to collect the testimony while the Holocaust survivors are still here, alive.
So that was 29 years ago, because...
It was 31 years ago. Yeah.
31 years ago. So yeah. It was a little before you were 70 then, because you're 99 today. Is that correct?
That was 7. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so you must have been in your late 60s at that time.
70s.
You were 7.
70s, yes.
Sorry, you said it was 19.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, you are completely right. I was a bit younger than I thought.
I'd like to ask you one or two more questions about UNRWA. That's a very interesting connection that you made there. Do you remember where you were working with UNRWA?
Yes, it was, the town was called Tübingen. And the French, in French zone, there were no camps for refugees. People lived privately, and UNRWA was arranging it. The Germans paid for the quarters, and in UNRWA, we got meals. There was a hunger in Germany after the war, and it was a very big privilege to eat with the French officers, the same army mess. We call it mess, I don't know.
So you were in Tübingen, you say?
In Tübingen, yes.
Yeah. And so it was the French that were overseeing that particular part of Germany at that time, in the French zone?
I got... I was officer of the second class in UNRWA.
Oh, you were?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And do you remember how many interviews you would have conducted?
Approximately 7 per day. I would say 50 or 60.
So you would interview them. Were they all Jewish survivors? Or
oh,
were
no,
they
no.
Refugees
it was just opposite. These were people, very often Germans, who pretended they're survivors so they could have some assistance from UNRWA. UNRWA provided some youth, even provided some clothes and so on. Actually, being a refugee in Germany was a privileged position. So people, Germans, Lithuanians, or other people who found themselves in work in Germany were not refugees, pretended they are refugees.
And in that process, did you get to hear real stories of survivors of the Holocaust or survivors of other atrocity that you heard sometimes?
Basically, people had to fabricate their stories so I could distinguish who were genuine refugees and who was not. For me, it was comparatively easy, yeah.
And did you record those stories? Were they written or how did you...
No. We simply said, yes, he deserves support. No, he doesn't deserve support.
But that was your introduction then to listening to the stories
yes.
of people who'd gone through World War II in different capacities.
Yeah.
So when you came to begin the project to video Holocaust testimonies, you were already volunteering at the Jewish Holocaust Museum Center?
Initially, I volunteered in the archives, and later on, I volunteered in collecting testimonies, and this became a passion, you know.
I believe there might have been a predecessor with a project called, was it called the Melbourne Oral History Project? Were you involved in that too?
No, initially not. I only, actually, they collected testimony initially on the audio tapes, and I did give a testimony, but I didn't collect any. It was Ursula Flicker who started this, who was very, very efficient.
And so when was the first time that you gave a formal testimony yourself?
It was about 2 years before, I would say. In 1984. Yeah, 1984.
And that was an audio testimony? Or
audio testimony on a tape. Yeah, audio tape.
An audio testimony. And then later on, then you moved to the Jewish Holocaust Center, is that correct?
Yes.
And you were volunteering, and then you were approached to begin the video testimonies.
Yeah. Yeah.
So tell me how you began that project. Did you have any other models to look at? How did you even start?
Actually, basically, I knew a person whom I wanted to interview. So I came to the person, and while I was talking to her about her past, it was a woman, I created the first interview form, and my task was to improve the interview form, and it continued right till the end. It was never finished because we always find some additional points, questions which we should ask, or the why we should ask, and so on.
Can I ask you the name of that lady?
Couldn't remember, sorry.
Oh, you can't remember, that's okay.
No.
And so you created an interview form. What is the interview form?
It was a questionnaire, which contained initially about 40 to 50 questions here. And this was one of my aims, the most important aims, to make the questionnaire as good as possible, you know.
Why was the interview form so important?
Basically, it enables a person to tell the his life story. Naturally, it could be only used as a guide because everybody got a different story. The big advantage which I had, that I went through the Holocaust and I knew the history of the Holocaust quite well. I read every possible book and watched every possible video about Holocaust. So during the interview, even if someone else was interviewing and I was present, I could help the interviewee to express his facts, the dates, and so on, the places.
And so the form that you created, was it the same form for everyone? Or was it different for each person?
Initially, we had one. Later on, we had a form for the second generation and the third generation. That was only about 6 or 7 years ago. Before, it was only one form. No, sorry. There was a special form for the people who survived the Holocaust in Soviet Union, who were in hiding and so on, because they had completely different experiences. Yeah.
So you adapted the form for different types of experience so that when you met the survivor or the witness, you would know in advance that they had been in hiding, and then you would use the hiding form. Is that correct?
That's right. Yeah.
And so what happens to the form? How do you use it in the interview?
So each interviewer got the form. Some interviewers, before the interview, would start a private conversation which will make them familiar with the way the people sing and express themselves, and at the same time, it would put the interviewee at ease. He would be speaking more freely. The people wanted to talk about their experiences. Whenever I picked up somebody to bring him to the Holocaust for the interview, which happened quite often, in the car they were already starting to tell me the story. And when they were interviewed properly, the spontaneity disappeared. It's important to tell the story for the first time.
So how did you balance the need to learn from them and do a pre-interview with the form and keeping the spontaneity?
That was quite a problem because I could say, oh, look, you will have an opportunity to tell the story later. But after 10 minutes, the person will start again. That was a problem which I could never solve.
So when you had the form, how long before the interview would you go and do the pre-interview with the form?
So there was no pre-interview like Spielberg Foundation had. We didn't have it.
So what did you do with the form then? How did you fill that in?
The interviewer would have this interview form, and it would be the guide to the question which he would ask. What was very, very important to establish a relationship of trust that the person could stress. The people were often forgetting, I wouldn't say often, but sometimes forgetting that everything what is recorded will be later seen by other people. And for instance, a woman who had divorced her husband and had a second husband was saying quite few unpleasant things about the first husband, and we have to stop her from saying it because this would be public.
So I just want to go back to the process then for a minute, if I can, Philip. So the form was there for to guide you during the interview.
Yeah, it was a guide for the interview, for myself and for the interviewer.
And then when you spoke to the survivor before the interview, you wouldn't do a pre-interview with them, a formal pre-interview. You would just learn about their story generally. Is that correct?
That's right. The only pre-interview, it was my first interview, when I had to create the form.
So tell me all about that first interview, the steps that you took. I'm very interested to learn how you did that very first interview.
This was a woman who was lucky to have boots. One of the most important things in the Holocaust was to preserve the boots, because in the frost you had to go through snow and the clogs were, the snow cling to the wooden clogs until people very often fell down, frost to death, and so on. This woman had boots, and the story of this Hoshimene to preserve the boots was an important story. Another thing is very interesting. When you mentioned boots during the Holocaust, people suddenly remembered the death marches when they didn't have any boots. And we found out that certain words were like symbols which stimulated the memory, and people remembered things which normally they didn't. Actually, we had once a very, very interesting case. There was a daughter who came to us and said, could you interview my father? Because he talks about the Holocaust non-stop. So we interviewed the father, and the father remembered many, many more things. This was rather important to make the person remember whatever he possibly he could put in his subconscious, and so on. Then we interviewed after a few weeks. I met the daughter and said, how is your father now? Oh, it's terrible. He remembers so many things, he talks even more. It worked in reverse. But sometimes they had that theoretic healing effects. Like once we have a fellow who, actually he was a Belgian, a very well educated person, but while he was reading a book about Holocaust, suddenly he got a shock and he couldn't perform normally. The fellow actually married an Australian woman, and she suggested that he should give a testimony to the Holocaust Center, and maybe it would help him psychologically to recover from the shock. And he did. After the interview, a few weeks, I got a call from him saying, look, the book I started to read in Belgium many, many years ago, I just finished reading, I'm completely cured. So it was.
And do you think it was the giving of the testimony that helped him to recover psychologically?
Yes, yes. Yes, it's definitely had a very beneficial effect. Yeah.
And was that true of many of the survivors, or did you have other examples?
You see, there is no objective reality. Everybody sees the world differently, remembers differently. We had a case where a fellow said, you know, the Holocaust didn't affect me at all, and so on. I congratulated him, shook his hand. When he came to pick up a copy of his interview, because everybody was getting the copy, he said, look, after I went back to my car, I had to sit for a half an hour to recover from the shock. It did have, it was subconsciously affecting everybody very deeply. And I personally believe the fact that they could express the trauma which was hidden within themselves helped them a lot.
Was that one of your intentions, to provide an opportunity for that healing to take place?
Side effect.
So what was your main intention then?
To get as much information and as the information to be as true as possible. You see, everybody remembers things differently. There is no objective truth. It's very, very subjective.
When you did your own testimony, Philip, before the project, what was that like for you as a person to go through that experience?
At this stage, I thought this is a very, very useful thing because this will preserve the memory of the Holocaust. But on the other hand, I really felt that it's a very primitive way to preserve it.
Why was it primitive?
Because interviewer wasn't properly trained.
Okay. So how did that make you feel when the interviewer did not know how to conduct the interview correctly?
I fulfilled the request from somebody to do it. But I felt it's not done as it should be done.
And was that a motivation for you to then become involved and do interviews yourself?
When I started, it was I could feel that we advanced so much that. The way we're interviewing now fulfilled the aim of collecting interviews much better than the very primitive way I was interviewing the first time.
Do you think it helped that you were a Holocaust survivor yourself?
Tremendously. Tremendously. Even my presence as a Holocaust survivor, as an interview, helps them. Because I felt, yes, there is somebody who will understand what I am talking. I think I mentioned to you that the Holocaust Center. Which is the fact that this, in the Holocaust Center there was a survivor present during the interview who would understand them better, played a big role. Why? Because the meaning of certain words was completely different. Like I mentioned this in my book, which is as important, that if we talk about gas, people think about cooking. Holocaust survivors think about gassing people. If we talk about selection, we don't think that you can be selecting an outfit for summer or winter, but you have no selection. You can see how people are selected for death, yourself or your nearest friends. When you talk about hunger, it's not hunger between two meals. It's a hunger, it's a feeling which completely overcomes everything else what it is. You can only think about food. Possibly you know that. If there were crumbs of bread between the rocks, I was eating. I was swallowing the rocks because people, the stomach overtakes the function of your brain.
How many of the interviews did you conduct yourself, Philip?
So I was present during that 1,000 interviews. How many were by? I never checked it.
So sometimes you would be the interviewer, sometimes somebody else would be the interviewer. Is that how it works?
Actually, yes. Yeah. I would say very close. If I was, no, look, I can't commit myself to any numbers, but it would be close to 1,000. Yes.
And Philip, how did you find the survivors to interview? What was your process to find them?
I was carrying in my pocket a pencil and a little booklet. And whenever I met a survivor, I took his name and tried to convince him he should give a testimony. And initially, I could book in. We had four people booked in 3 weeks in advance. It's I had a very, very, very unpleasant case when I booked somebody in and he passed away before he could give a testimony. And the family could not forgive me that I didn't interview him before. But who can predict this, an event like that will happen?
No, that's a difficult one. So you would carry a book around with a pencil and you would write down people's
in
names.
In my pocket,
and then you
yeah.
How many said no to you?
Very few. I spent a lot of time trying to convince them.
And what were their reasons not to give a testimony? When they were talking and you were convincing them, why were they reluctant?
Yeah, right. Sometimes people would say, look, I don't want anybody to know what happened. Maybe they, you know, some people cooperated with Germans, or their past wasn't so clear. One of the most important questions, I had a good friend who, before he started uni, he came to me and said, he wanted to find out something about the Holocaust. I said, it's not only important to survive the Holocaust, it is important the way you survived. And later on, he wrote a book which he called A Gray Zone, where actually he discusses how people sometimes morally or ethically were not completely right. This is another problem that I personally felt that some people who wanted to save a life, their life by cooperating with Germans willingly, not were should be condemned for their work, for their work during the Holocaust. You see, what's very important when collecting testimony, to get the testimony completely truthful. And these people would simply consciously lie. And we record it. But whenever things like this happen, I would ask the question, are you sure it happens now? I mean, and I would repeat the question a few times of the people when they would be viewing the testimony would realize that something might be not completely true there.
You're raising a very important point here, in that very few Holocaust survivor testimonies do have the experiences, for example, of capos or Jewish police or so on. And we know that they existed everywhere. So did you have anybody in your collection who did speak honestly about their role when they might have been in the gray zone? Or did everybody, in your view, use that deception?
The biggest problem is that these people haven't got conscious. They not only describe the events which happened and their role during this event, but they're proud of it. Do you get it? This is one of the most embarrassing things, that there are people like that who really have no ethical and moral conscience.
So while we are talking about the difficulties of always telling the full truth, can you talk to me a moment or two about the truthfulness or otherwise of testimony? In other words, is this a sacred truth, or how do we read this in a way that will be most informative for us?
You see, the process of testimony is that people reveal their private life publicly. And the image which they want to create sometimes is more important than the truth. They embellish the truth. And this again, whenever I notice the exaggeration or a lie, I could always ask, sure. And sometimes people say, oh, maybe I was wrong, maybe my memory is not right. But the testimony is an expression of a person, of his personality. I don't know if I'm completely right, but subconsciously I would judge the person by the way he would describe the events. And when I would see that the description is not completely correct, that the person tries to make himself a hero or try to make the story very, very interesting because he thinks that it would be nice for his family or for other people to hear that stuff. I felt that this is like a betrayal of the truth, which should be avoided and eliminated as much as I can.
Do Holocaust survivors sometimes lie?
Yeah. You see, it's... There are, should I say, there are professional liars. There are some people who are never truthful. This is a part of their makeup.
And can we trust? Oh, sorry.
And our job is to distinguish between the truthful people and not. But this is a great man. It's only a small minority.
So how do we distinguish, Philip?
Pardon?
How do we distinguish?
How do I distinguish? I knew enough about the Holocaust, the history of the Holocaust, to know what's true and what's not.
And if you heard something that was obviously not truthful, would you challenge the survivor who was telling something
untruthful? Oh, yes, yeah. I would ask the question, are you sure? And I would repeat the question few times.
And was there ever a time that they changed their story when you challenged them?
Some of them would change, some wouldn't. It's again depends on the individual. You see, this is a human factor. We're all different.
So as a whole, can we trust testimony as a medium?
Yes. Why it's important? Because we got documents. It's extremely important to support the documents with a description of the events, how they felt, and the distortions which I mentioned are rare. Major distortions are rare. Most of it are as truthful as people can see it.
When you were listening to these testimonies, did you learn new things from them? And if so, give me an example of something that you might have learned.
I will learn a lot. I will learn a lot because everybody is different and everybody responds differently to events which confront him. I learned about human nature. I learned about the events. And some events were unbelievable, but they were completely true. And that was extremely important to preserve it.
When you were looking for survivors to give testimony, were you looking for particular types of experience, or was it just whoever came to the door and was willing to talk to you?
Anybody who's willing to talk to me. Yeah.
Do you think that there are testimonies missing, if you like, from the collection that you wish you did have more of, maybe?
Um, No, I just accept it as it comes, you know. I'm just trying to think if there was... I possibly would like to have more testimony from people who survive, not the concentration camp, but who were deported to Russia or who ran away to Russia. Yeah.
I have to say, I found your testimony very compelling because I've heard very few testimonies of those who were in the Baltic states throughout, you know,
yes.
more about Lithuania, but not so much Latvia, and very little about Estonia. So your testimony was very important for me to learn from because of the Baltic connection, for example.
Yes. What is interesting is that I was interviewing people from Vilna who had similar experience. I have to admit, their testimonies were superior to mine. Which was a pleasant experience.
I would start to go back a little bit more now to talk about the mechanics of running an archive like this.
Yes.
So where did you get your first camera from and who advised you and how did you learn the technical skills?
So actually, photography was my hobby. So, when I got a job of interviewing in the Holocaust Center, there was a course at Melbourne University where they taught you how to collect, actually it was a bit of the testimonies too, how to produce films and it was only a 1 week course, but very extensive. And I learned a lot about the composition and so on with the photography. And being my hobby, I was practicing a lot actually. When my children grew up, I was traveling a lot and I was traveling always with a video camera, and I was interviewing people about the conditions, about their life in the country which I was visiting, which was very interesting. I was interviewing people in the Soviet Union, where everybody would tell me, I would like to see you in Australia, which meant I would like to run away from Soviet Union and come to Australia, things like that.
So wait a minute, I want to clarify. You went to the Soviet Union?
Yes.
When did you go to the Soviet Union?
It was in 1948.
48. And you said you were interviewing people?
Yeah.
You were talking to...
Yeah. My job was to meet the local people and tell them, I'm from Australia, would you like to say a few words for my friends?
And wait a minute. So what year was this? Not 48. What year was it?
It was 6 months before the Berlin Wall was collapsed.
1988.
Sorry, 1988. Sorry. Yeah,
so you traveled to the Soviet Union and you were interviewing people in the Soviet Union and you were asking them, just tell me what you were asking them about.
Actually, I speak well Russian. My first language at home was Russian. And I was encountering a new system where I knew that secret police plays an almost very important role. So I was very careful not to ask too much. But we never had an opportunity to... I had a case where our... We're traveling by a coach, 30 people in a coach, Trafalgar tour, which started from London and went to Soviet Union. And between Moscow and Leningrad, or St. Petersburg is now, there is a stop where everybody had to stop overnight in Russia. If somebody didn't, it took 4 hours from Leningrad to come to this place, and the same thing for, if somebody didn't arrive in time, the secret police immediately checked why was the delay. There was, because our coach broke down and we had to stay for an extra 2 hours, I went to this place where all the travelers have to stay overnight. And I met a girl who was working for secret police. She was very, very friendly. And one of the questions I asked her, would you like to travel overseas? The Russians, not allowed to. She answered, oh no, you know, I have to pack and unpack so much travel. I would rather stay in Soviet Union. So I asked the question, but you have no right to travel overseas. Is it any hindrance? She couldn't answer the question. This was in time of Gorbachev. I don't know if you heard about Perestroika. Anyway, Gorbachev wanted to introduce new laws in Soviet Union to bring it closer to the West. She was supervised by another fellow who was a communist. And he said to me, look, traveling overseas, eventually it would be possible. Rome wasn't built in one day. Saying eventually they would do. You see, this question, very embarrassing question for them, but I risked.
That type of, let's just say, travel and hobby and photography was all building the story for you in terms of your passion, ultimately, to take testimony?
It helped a lot. It did help a lot. It did definitely help a lot. Yeah.
So let's go back to the camera. So what was your first camera that you used? Do you remember?
Yeah, it was a Voigtländer, actually. Comparatively primitive camera. But I bought it in Germany. At this stage, the German mark has no value. You couldn't buy anything in the shops. So I had to buy this money and few cigarettes for it. few cigarettes. The cigarettes were so rare.
And so then you were an avid photographer all the way through your life then?
Yeah, actually, I mentioned this in my book, you know. One day I was sitting at the window, and on the window sill, a bird came down, and I wanted to take a photo of it, and it flew away. And from then on, I always wanted to have a camera that I can catch the moment.
So when you came to start the Holocaust Survivor Testimony Project, what video camera did you use?
Initially, would you believe I still got the camera? It was a Sony, a very old VHS camera.
So you filmed directly onto VHS?
Yeah, filmed on VHS, and then we were making copies. One for the person who has done it, and kept the original there. Sometimes we had a request for a few copies, so we did.
You would do too. I just want to do a little check with you, Philip. We've been filming for about an hour. Do you need a little break?
No,
some
it's
water?
All right.
You want to keep going?
Yeah.
So initially you filmed it in VHS. You would then make one copy or, if requested, two copies.
Yes.
And they would go to the families.
Yeah. What was important too, that I was trying to get a copy of any film which was shown on television. So myself were copying, and I had some friends who were copying any film, so who had a home, I would say, almost 1,000 films related to the Holocaust.
So this was when you would use your VCR at home, or
yes,
you would have other people, and if it was a documentary or a film, you would make a VCR copy of the film that was shown on the TV, and then you would keep it in the center.
Yeah, you see, that was, again, important. Why? First thing, I would find out the facts, historical facts, about which I didn't know. Second thing, I could find out how they interpret the events.
Does that film archive of recorded films still exist at the center?
I assume it should be existing, still there, yeah.
So you worked on VHS for a while, and then what happened as the technology developed? How did you change your cameras and your use of technology over time?
So, the time was progressing, we're getting digital cameras and so on, and it was comparatively easy to get used to it. My experience as automotive electrician helped me to adjust to the new conditions.
How often would you update?
We update about 3 times, 4 times. Yeah. Yeah.
So you updated your
eventually,
the format.
Eventually we record it on the chip, you know.
So now you're recording on a data card, on a chip.
On the chip.
Yeah. What camera do you use now? Do you remember?
The last one. A Sony. I couldn't remember exactly the type.
That's fine. Now, I noticed that you have a very standard format using a backdrop.
Yes.
Behind. Talk to me about the choice, your creative choice, and why you did it that way.
You see, Holocaust Center was always short of finance. So there was a volunteer, a German volunteer, who was helping me. He was very, very capable. And he created a screen covered with a black cloth. Black cloth I got from a friend who had a factory who's producing materials. And it served us for about 20 years.
So let's just talk through the process that would occur from the time that you first contacted the survivor all the way through the interview and after. What were the steps you would take with the survivor?
The first, I'll get his details and so on. Second thing, I will set up the diet where he was to come. Some had transport, some had to pick up to bring them to the Holocaust Center. Then, or we wait a few minutes until the interviewer will arrive, so I could establish a personal contact visit. If the interviewer was there, would be starting a pro. I would set the camera and everything else, which will take about 5 minutes. When everything would be ready, I would give a signal and the interviewer will start interviewing. Initially, we're taking the photo of the interviewer and later on the photo of the interviewee. Just because it was time consuming, we stopped taking the photo of the interviewer, which is a pity, but this is in hindsight. You know, now I can feel that it was a pity we didn't do it.
So the interviewee would come to the Jewish Holocaust Center in Melbourne, yeah, and you would have a space there? Where did you film?
So initially, we had a... It was a little shed with a leaking roof. And it wasn't very big. It was very narrow. And when the people would come, they could, because it was dark, narrow, and primitive, people could isolate themselves from the daily life and completely concentrate on the testimony. The later on, they got much more elaborate quarter zone when I felt the atmosphere in this very primitive shed was an adventure. It was actually, we even put a flower there, artificial flower, and it was raining. I was saying, oh, we're watering the flower. The roof couldn't be repaired. One of the biggest problems in the Holocaust Center was finance. We never had enough money and every penny. Actually, what was very nice, that a lot of people after the interview donated to the project, which usually I could give to the Holocaust Center, to support the Holocaust Center.
So let's talk a little bit about finances. So how did you fund these interviews? What were the costs and how did you find the money?
So actually, the way we were doing it, the interviews, the interviewers, everybody was a volunteer. And the volunteers supported financially the Holocaust Center, including myself.
So all aspects of the filming, the preparation, the...
Was contributing financially to the Holocaust Center. It wasn't draining. It wasn't a drain on the money, but just the opposite.
So sometimes people would make donations so that you could contribute the other way.
Oh, yeah. Actually, sometimes quite substantial donation.
And how long was the typical interview that you would conduct?
The shortest one was about 3/4 hour. The longest, 10 hours. It's actually the one which was 10 hours. It was consisting of 3 or 4 sessions.
3 or 4 different days that person would come in.
Yeah, that's right. I would say their average interview was only about an hour and a half or 2 hours.
And when you would have these different interviewers come to work with you, how would you train the interviewer to be an interviewer?
Actually, when I came and started, I inherited already few interviewers who were usually psychologists, doctors, and so on, were quite good qualification in dealing with people. The basic problem was that the interviews were not conducted frequently enough. People were there, but they were not. And again, not everybody could come every week and so on. We had about 30 interviewers initially, which is
so. How often would you conduct interviews? Was it weekly or monthly?
Oh, every day. Every day, sometimes 6 days a week.
And so was there a period when you were busier in doing the interviews? Did it change over time?
Initially, we were very, very busy. I was booked out 3 weeks in advance. Gradually, it was much more difficult. Initially, people wanted to talk. You know, it was very easy for people to convince to give a testimony. And later on, it became more and more difficult.
So later it became more difficult?
Yes.
Why was that, do you think?
Because I had to convince people who were not so eager to talk about it that they should.
So in other words, what you're saying is, at the beginning of the project, there were more volunteers.
Oh, yeah.
More eager.
Very, very keen. Everybody was keen to talk. Look on you for an opportunity.
So what year did you start? It was 1990, was it?
1992.
So you started in 1990.
I still worked in the archives till 92.
So you worked in the archives till 92, and then you began this project in 92.
Yeah.
How did the development of, for example, the screening of Schindler's List or new projects like the Shoah Foundation impact the way in which survivors saw their role in society? Was there a change in any way between 92 and, say, 94 or 5?
Oh, yes, big change. Big change. Because in 94 to 95, we lost a lot of interviewers. And one of the most important was Jerry Krass, who was coming every day to interview, and actually it was and then I was interviewing too. Then my role as interview, previously I was mainly videotaping it. Now I interviewed sometimes. It was rather difficult to interview and to film at the same time, but we had very good, devoted people who operated the camera, filmmakers, and you see, this aim to preserve the history of the Holocaust became very, very important to not only to Holocaust survivors, but people non-Jewish who felt they could play an important role. And I had very, very valuable and capable people cooperated. Really excellent.
So who would be your crew on a day-to-day basis? Who would be there?
Usually the interviewer, myself. Sometimes, on a very rare occasions, somebody of the family would like to stay. We tried to avoid it because people, when they talk to the camera, talk differently, but there's somebody from the family is present.
And did you operate the camera? Who operated the camera?
So, initially I was the only operator of the camera. Later on, I had people helping me.
And did you use lights and microphones? How did that work?
We had lights. I usually checked it before the interview. I would set up the lights on. Sometimes during, just when we were starting, I have to change the lights. But I learned a lot from my assistants, from people who are filmmakers. And basically, I'm indebted a lot to all the people who cooperate with me. I would never be able to do the work I have done if not for the assistants. I'm really, really indebted and grateful for their assistance.
Philip, how would you define who was eligible to contribute to the archive?
In what way?
Well, was it just Jewish survivors? Was it people who are not Jewish? How did they qualify?
Generally, I accepted anybody who offered these services. Some had to learn on the job. Some were very slow. Because we not only had to film it, we have later on to catalog it and so on.
I didn't clarify what I was saying. The people who, the interviewees that came to give their story, how did they qualify to be a witness of the Holocaust? What was the...
They have to go through a training period. Yeah, they had to read a certain amount of books. They had to study the process of interview, and then they had to interview me, and I would decide if they're qualified enough. If not, they had to go back, study again.
So after doing the training, you would sit for them, and they would interview you for a while, and then you would make a determination?
Yes, yeah. You see, there is something about the interview. You have to have inborn talent. Some people had it, some people didn't have it. And
did you reject many?
Few, yes. Everybody was very keen to be an interviewer, actually. But I had to reject many of those, yeah. And we were interviewing in different languages. So again, the skill of interviewing in Yiddish, French, German.
So I wanted to ask you that question. How many languages are in your collection?
About 5 languages.
5 languages. And so did you give the interviewee the choice of the language that they would be interviewed in?
So, usually I would prefer them to give it in English. But some people who are very, I don't know if you heard about Bund. Bund was a Jewish organization who belonged to the Bund, and they felt if they have to give an interview, they have to give it only in Yiddish. Or they were giving in Yiddish, or if I was interviewing, I would ask the question in Yiddish, translate them, and translate the answer to English. So people who didn't know Yiddish could watch the testimony. And this was very successful.
So you would do continuously translating, simultaneous translation to the interview?
Yeah, and this was really, really good.
Did you do that in other languages than Yiddish?
I speak Russian. I speak Polish. English.
So in those languages, if you were interviewing in Russian, Polish, or Yiddish, then you would do a simultaneous translation?
So, basically, only in Yiddish I had simultaneous translation. You know why? Because these testimonies were very important. Like, people who cooperated in underground and so on.
Are all of the witnesses, all of the interviewees, are they all Jewish?
No. Actually, we interviewed, first there was a fellow, a German fellow. You see, initially Germans claimed that only Nazis persecuted Jews. The Wehrmacht didn't participate. He actually was a German who could prove that the Wehrmacht cooperated quite strongly. He came to Melbourne and he gave an interview.
But so how did you decide if somebody was a witness of the Holocaust that you would classify for your archive to be interviewed?
I would like to collect as many testimonies as possible. For instance, there was a visitor from United States, a woman who, the fact that the Jewish citizens were deported from Germany to Poland the Germans didn't recognize their German citizens, they became Polish citizens. Poland didn't want to accept them. It was Friday, a woman came there, and just because I had time, I interviewed her. Some interviews were not planned, but on the spur of the moment. What was very interesting that the people who interviewed and told me their story became personal friends. Later on, I would meet these people. There were too many, I couldn't even remember all of them. Suddenly, the people I was walking in the street with my wife, and a nice blonde suddenly said hello to me. And my wife asked me, who was it? She became suspicious because the hello was a friend, you know?
So you made deep relationships with the people who gave the interviews?
Oh, yeah.
Did any become lifelong friends, or did you find new friendships?
Yes. We find something in common. You see, I admire people who were decent, who value the ethics more than their personal hardship. And with these people I established close friendship. Like, I call them decent people.
How have the attitudes of Holocaust survivors changed over the last 30 years since you've been interviewing?
A lot. As people, we did interview people for the second time, special to find out exactly how did they change. And what did we find out? They mellowed. The strong height to the perpetrators suddenly disappeared. People got softer. Certain facts which they mentioned before, they didn't mention second time because they didn't think it's important enough. And the other things became very important. Their values changed. We do, as we grow up, we change. And a period of 10 years or so, or 15 years sometimes, made a big difference.
Did the story change?
Basically, the story didn't change, but the description of the story changed.
We're going to have to stop.
Good.
Okay.
We're going to have to take a break because I've got to change cards.
And, okay, great.
And there's also some gardening that's just started to happen next door. So I just want to see what's going on, if you don't mind.
So we'll take a few minutes break. I'll leave the speaker on. And then do you need to stretch your legs a little, Philip? Are you okay?
Yeah. I will have a bit of a rest.
I'm stopping.
Okay, I'm just going to put the lights on in here. It's getting rather dark as well, so we'll take a little break.
Good.
Breath.
Okay, I'm recording. So this is take two of Philip Maisel in Melbourne, 5th of the 11th, interviewed by Stephen Smith in California on Zoom. Okay, and ready to go.
So, Philip, we were just talking about how survivors have changed over time,
yeah.
And you were telling me about the fact that you've interviewed some of them twice, and that actually the main story remains the same, even though some of the descriptions change. Can you talk to me a little bit about what those changes are?
First thing I told you, they are a bit mellow now. You know, they are not so, the memories are not hurting them so much. You see, the person is more mature and the basic changes are I would say more reasonable the person has learned something during this period, and he's using this wisdom in description of the events. There is a possibility that certain events have been forgotten, but this I can't vouch for, and it's if I could say the person is more at peace with himself. He learned to accept things in life which previously possibly were too difficult to accept.
Do you think in some ways that the changes in family dynamics and economic dynamics or personal circumstances change their attitude as well in some way?
Personal circumstances, definitely. It's relation with a wife. Sometimes the wife is not alive anymore. Children grew up. And in some were quite obvious differences with children who are growing up at different, have different views than themselves. The feeling that they know everything disappears. They suddenly realize that there are many things which they misjudged in the past. It's a process of growing. I would have to think. I really couldn't comment any more on it.
So it's a very interesting insight that you have shared there, Philip. How has your own journey over time changed for you, changed you as a person? Has this project itself changed you in any way?
So the project itself changed me a lot because I learned a lot about human being, about psychology of different people. It's strange, it might sound strange, but it was process of learning. At each interview I learned something about history and about the person who was describing it. And about the interviewer who was asking the questions.
But how are you different now to what you were, say, 30 years ago?
Oh, completely, completely different. Completely. My values changed completely because I put a very big emphasis on decency of the person. If unfortunately the world is not a very just place, there is a lot of injustice in all the communities, there is a lot of hatred, there is a lot of distortion of the truth, intentional distortion. And I feel that the aim of everybody should be to teach the people to be more objective, less selfish, and more humane. The word humane is, I would say, one of the most important things in my life now. I want to influence anybody in my family and even strangers to respond to life in the proper way. What I mean a proper way? To avoid prejudice, to avoid hatred, and to avoid intentional distortion of the truth. As I said, there is no objective truth, but there is an objective lie. Is there the intentional lie? And this has to be avoided at any cost.
Let's talk about denial for a moment, and to what extent your archival efforts have been about ensuring that denial doesn't form a part of the future. What role does that play in your thinking?
I learned something very interesting, that people deny because they were brought up this way. And one of the most important things which we should aim to do in life, to educate people the right way, so the denial wouldn't exist. Denial is some kind of ignorance. And one of the most important aims of the book which I wrote was to educate people to be able to distinguish between truth and lies.
Philip, tell me more about your book. What is it called and why did you write it?
Actually, the book is... I had a book here in front of me.
Sorry.
This is Sean, who's our videographer.
Yeah. This is a book. The Keeper of Miracles. Because I claimed that to survive, you needed one or more miracles. And by collecting testimonies, I was preserving the memories. But I wrote the book because about 3 years ago, one of the fellows who was collecting testimonies from Australian war heroes ran out of material and thought maybe in the Holocaust Center he will find somebody else with similar memories. And we struck a bit of a friendship, and he conducted an interview with me. He was very, very well prepared, a brilliant man. And later on, he worked for a publisher, Penn Macmillan, and they published a book called The Happiest Man on Earth, which was very, very successful. And he thought maybe my testimony would be voice while recording, and he suggested that I write a book. He paid me for it. He provided a ghostwriter, an excellent ghostwriter. And the final project, it was a book which was in many ways corrected by Pat McMillan. And I think it was quite successful at the present moment. It is successful.
And what was your aim with the book? What is the main point of what you wanted to say?
I wanted to teach people to be decent. You see, actually, this is a quotation from the book. A person who hears a testimony became a witness to the testimony, and he could pass it on to the future generation. The lesson of Holocaust is very, very important, and it shouldn't be forgotten.
Well, thank you for sharing that, Philip, and for taking the time to write it and to make sure it's there for us.
You see, what was important, that there were different people who saved my life, because they were humane. They were Latvian, Germans, and so on. Theoretically, they were my enemies. In practice, they helped me to survive. And there is no bigger gift of life, and they actually did it. It's like looking backwards, it's a very pleasant feeling that in this terrible period when so many people were destroyed, we still find decent people try to help somebody to survive. It's the actual feeling is much stronger than you can even describe in the book. And there are many questions. Why? The question is because they were humane. I thought this was a very, very important factor. And we should emphasize it.
Are you hopeful for humanity?
A very embarrassing question. I would say yes. But if you would ask me why, because I just want to be an optimist, this conscientious aim to survive, we have to be an optimist.
When you think about the archive of testimonies that you have collected, how would you like them to have impact on future generations?
A lesson not to be forgotten, mistakes not to be repeated, and hatred eliminated.
I want to ask you just about the preservation of your collection. What steps have you taken so far to make sure that the archive is preserved for the future?
That's very... Her contact with you is so important. The way you are preserving is really excellent. and I'm very, very, very grateful that it can be done, it can be preserved the way you're preserving it. It's beyond anybody's imagination that something like that could be created. Thank you very, very much for it. I really, from the depths of my heart, would like to thank you for it.
Well, I also want to thank you from the depth of my heart for the dedication and commitment that you have given for 3 decades to ensuring that these very precious testimonies have been collected. And I know that our organizations are working very closely together to make sure that your work is preserved and that it is there for the future. I think I would like to get a sense, if we're now talking to future generations a little, from you, where would you like to see these testimonies being used? What would give you satisfaction to know?
Look, this is historical material, psychological material, and at the present moment, the science develops very, very fast. And it contains a lot of knowledge which could be used in a different aspect in a different way. Actually, I feel that I can't even predict it in which way it could be, because technology and science is progressing at extremely fast, in extremely fast way. It's you see, we're preserving the feeling and lives of the people. Actually, apart from them, this is for future generations. People will know who were their parents, grandparents, and maybe great-great-parents. And definitely, it is important for the person to know where do they come from. It's it's part of our past, but as they say, there is no present without the past.
In terms of talking about the next generation, Philip, have you taken testimonies with second generation or third generation interviewees?
Yes.
Can you tell me about that?
Actually, the second and the third generation, there are different people. They evaluate the past differently. It's extremely interesting, the relationship between the second and the first generation. The first generation could learn the language much slower and could adjust themselves to the new conditions with bigger difficulties than the second. The children had very often had to help their parents with English, with solving problems with the everyday life. The children were, the relationship changed. The children somehow had to take over the role of the parent to the parents. The third generation is completely different. This is a typical consumer society. People want to be happy. They don't feel that they are owing the community something in return for the happiness which they derive from the community. They're more selfish. And the Jewishness, which was so important for their parents, disappeared. What I mean, the conscience of Jews, there's a lot of intermarriages. More than 60% of Jewish kids in Australia intermarry. In majority of the cases, the children are not brought up in the Jewish tradition. Interesting that the Jewish religion changed into Jewish tradition. If the third generation observes the Jewishness, it's mainly the tradition, not the religious principles.
And for the third generation, how have things changed for them?
So, basically, the conditions in which they live form them. The life is much easier. It's a consumer society where bombarded from everywhere to buy, to buy, to buy. And actually, the essence of happiness is not what you have, but the ability to give. And not many of the third generation realized.
And have you been interviewing some third generation?
Yes, yes. This is the result of the interview.
And these are your observations from the interviews?
Yeah, yeah. Actually, a person of the third generation, very capable girl, who's usually conducting the interviews, it's a different world, you know? And the kids are product of this world. How important are the testimony of their parents and grandparents? It depends on the individual. I should say yes. The great majority felt this is very, very important to know about their grandparents, and most of them very grateful for us in the Holocaust Center collecting their testimonies.
Philip, are there times when you yourself were traumatized by listening to testimony or re-traumatized from your own past?
Yes. Yeah. There were times the need of putting out of their chest, if I can say so, to people had in their subconscious hidden certain facts. And they did describe the facts in a great detail. And this was shocking. Yeah, yeah.
And how did you cope with that?
Just trying to tell myself, I am the machine here who records, and the feeling are of the second importance.
And what has kept you going for so long, this project?
It became an obsession. It was, subconsciously it was the most important thing which happened in my life. I was running to the Holocaust, leaving my lunch behind. My daughter had to bring my lunch. Everything what was I was doing was revolving around the testimony project.
Were there ever times that you felt like giving up?
No, never. Never. Actually, it's strange. The more difficult it became, the stronger was the will to overcome the difficulties. An obsession is a dangerous thing.
Do you intend to continue?
Look, at the present moment even, I still often think about the testimonies and about people who assisted me in working the testimonies. Like, you see, they hardly got any recognition. That's the people who were helping me to collect the testimonies, to catalog the testimonies. And I'm still friends with these people who are still alive, who helped me.
Are there any people that you would like to mention or thank now? Are there some people that you have in mind?
Yes, Kurt Friedlander, who was never properly acknowledged. He was a very dedicated fellow. Jerry Krass, who was an excellent interviewer, an excellent assistant.
How important was the Jewish Holocaust Center in making this whole project possible for you?
Pardon? Sorry.
So how important was the Jewish Holocaust Center as a partner in making this project possible?
Very much so. Very much so. Look, they felt that the project is important, and whenever I needed some support, I always got it. It's the Testimonies project was an important part of the work which Holocaust Center was doing. And I felt it. The good thing that everybody appreciated it, particularly the people who gave the testimony, and always try to give a small donation towards the Holocaust Center, or something, big donation as well.
And did you ever think about partnering, for example, with the Shoah Foundation?
So, actually, this was a very big misunderstanding. It could have been better if there were more cooperation, but there was no cooperation whatsoever.
And can you tell me what happened?
I did tell you in the past. Actually, the first meeting of the representatives of the Shoah Foundation, whom I met in Paris, were not properly skilled to do their job. When the Shoah Foundation came here, actually, I felt that the Shoah Foundation has better resources, and possibly I could feel that they not only didn't appreciate our work, but felt that our work is not necessary anymore because they can do the work better. And actually, luckily, I persevered and I continued collecting testimonies.
Well, I want to, I'm going to formally apologize to you, Philip, for the fact that our team was not properly prepared and was not able to see the dedication and commitment and vision and skill that you had. I want to make that clear to you that that was a very big oversight on the part of the Shoah Foundation. I apologize.
Oh no, thanks. I just accepted the matter. What was interesting, there was a meeting in Paris after which I went to Israel, and there was conflict between Shoah Foundation and is Jerusalem.
Yad Vashem.
Yad Vashem. And this definitely didn't help. But we're talking about the ideal world. There is no ideal world. There are always problems. And luckily problems are being solved, and so very satisfactory result.
Yeah, well, I can't tell you how very honored we are to be able to preserve your collection, to work with the Jewish Holocaust Center in Melbourne, to make sure that the dedication of three decades of work is ensured for the future. We will undertake and promise you that we will make sure that those testimonies that you have taken and have made possible, and those lives that you have saved, will continue to live in the archive and be shared with the world. And one of the reasons I wanted to talk to you today as the oral historian who has put this collection together is to understand what your motives were, how you went about your work, and what your vision is for the future, so that we can do a good job in ensuring that we fulfill your vision. And I want to thank you on behalf of the Shoah Foundation, obviously, but also on behalf of all those people in the future that will listen to these testimonies and will learn from them in the way that you outlined a few moments ago, because they are indeed a very precious treasure for the future. And I can't wait myself to listen to more of them, because I have so far, those that I have heard have been very moving and very touching to hear. So, Philip, I want to just thank you for taking the time with us today, and for all that you have done, because it's a real gift for the future. Thank you so much.
And I have only one feeling to you, feeling of gratitude. I'm really, really, the thank you is not only the thank you, but from the deepest feeling from my heart, I really thank you.
Well, Philip Maisel, unless there's anything else that you feel that you would like to share with me about this collection, is there anything that I haven't asked that you would feel that you would like to share with me?
No, I'm looking forward to see your book.
You're going to be in it, because you said some things today that I think were really profound, and thank you for sharing them. And as soon as I can, I'll be in Melbourne so that we can meet in person once again, and I look forward to that very much. So Philip Maisel, on behalf of the Shoah Foundation at USC, thank you.
Thank you very much too. Thanks. Bye.
Thank you.